I forgot that was my cue.
We're so smooth at this. Professionals.
But hey, look, we got a new logo.
We do.
Well, not really new, but... Oh, hey, good morning, everybody. Oh, come on, Sharon, gotta get in.
No, I can do it.
Oh, yeah, all right, everybody, how's the chat this morning? Everybody got a little chair dancing going? Yeah.
For a party, yeah.
Woohoo. Chris, how is Ottawa this morning?
Oh my gosh, it's a scorcher. We're in the middle of a heat wave. 3 days of plus 30 degrees Celsius, which I think in Fahrenheit is 454. It's because all my papers are burning. That's how I'm recognizing that. So,
you've got a nice breeze blowing through your hair, so you're looking fabulous today.
I figured if I just chair dance the whole time, no one will really notice that I've actually got a fan blowing on me.
That's a heck of a chair dance.
There you go. Yeah, I was just going to say, it's the chair, the head-banging chair dance. We'll be changing our music to Swedish black dark metal.
Only in the winter, though.
Chris, we have a fabulous guest today. Who are we talking to today?
We are talking to Sharon Boller. Has come up. Oh, my God, all my words are gone. Where did they go? We have Sharon Boller with us. Ta-da! Short and sweet.
This is the part where you improvise.
Oh, yes.
Doodly-doo.
Yes. I was actually kind of distracted because there's a lot of folks talking about the weather, and I always like to check that out. And Sean is also in Ottawa. Our own Sierra from our team is here, is joining us from Ottawa as well. And yeah, we're whining about the heat, but that's life.
You guys, you and your faux heat.
I know. I know. It's still like 30 degrees Fahrenheit cooler than Brent in Arizona, and but we're whining about it. You know. Yeah. I know. Anyway. So Sharon Boller is joining us here today. Sharon, give us just a bit of an introduction to yourself. It's your first time being with us, so maybe a bit of a background. Let folks know who you are and where you've come from.
I am literally from Indianapolis, Indiana. So it is mostly sunny right now and actually pretty nice here. So no whines for me. I have been in this field for longer than I care to admit. Let's just say it is on the far side of 25 years. Have a master's in instructional design that I got back in the 90s. From IU, and had a business for a long number of years, Bottom Line Performance, and based in Indy. Grew that business from just me way back in 1995 when it started to 36 peeps, and recently sold that business last September to Tier One Performance, where I am still hanging out, and have a big passion for all things learning. Curiosity would be one of my top values. And so I'm always curious and always learning. I love tech. I like exploring all the new stuff. But I'm really passionate about doing it right and about creating great experiences for people. So I kind of geek out on the learning stuff.
And ML is just thrown in the chat. There's nothing in all caps wrong with having experience.
That's true.
Because all three of us here are sometimes embarrassed to admit how much experience we have. It reveals too much about us, maybe sometimes. But experience is a big part of the word, a big word in our title of today's session, focusing on learner experience design. We'll toss it out now. You've got a book coming out. I think it's June 9th.
Yes.
And you said you had a copy of the cover because it doesn't actually exist yet as a whole book. If you wanted to share that with us, give us a glimpse of that.
Hang on one sec, and I shall. Maybe.
And Sharon, is this your first book?
Oh gosh, no. Let's see. Let's go share. And let's try sharing over here. And now you're seeing probably a PowerPoint because that's what it's sitting on.
Yeah, yep. That's okay.
Yep. There's the book. And I'll stick the URL to Amazon in there just because. This is my third book. So I wrote my first one back in 2005. It was on team training for ATD. And then I swore to God I would never do another one because it was so painful. And the only reason that one got done was because I was traveling a lot and I would write on airplanes. And then Carl Kopp and I kind of got hooked up and became buddies in game-based learning. And we started doing workshops together back in 2012. And I said, I think we should write a book on this together. And we did. And after that one was done, I swore to God I would never write another one. And then I got so interested in design thinking and realizing this is a better way to think about how we create learning. And I did it again. I said, I think we should write a book about this. And so this is my third one. I'm not going to say never again, because it seems to be the magnet for doing another one.
Yeah, it's the fate testing you. You're flying too close to the sun. Let's bring her down a bit. Give her another book to write.
Yeah.
For sure. You said you got so fascinated by design thinking. And maybe let's start with just as sort of thumbnail-y a description of design thinking.
Okay.
As you can to get us started. And then we'll move on to what it is about it that that's really drawn you in.
Okay. I'm going to share my screen one more time just because it's got 5 steps to design thinking. And I think that's really useful to kind of have a reference. So this is design thinking, the steps, the concept, you empathize, and it's about problem solving, by the way. Design thinking is not about design and how you design stuff. It's about how you design the solution to problems. So it starts with empathizing. And if you think in the world of product development or the people that we're creating products that we want to sell, you start by empathizing with whomever your user is going to be or whoever is experiencing this problem. And you go out and you look at their world and you talk to them and you see what their frame of reference is, what their barriers are, what their needs are, how they interact with the world, et cetera. So that's the kind of the frame for design thinking. So if you were going to design a whole line of cutlery for people who perhaps have arthritic hands, you would want to go and talk to people who have arthritic hands. You would want to watch how they use regular cutlery. You'd want to explore it and kind of figure out, well, what would need to be unique about how we design this to make it work for them. So then from there, you go into problem definition. Now that I understand the world, let me more clearly define this problem that we need to solve. And then you would go into ideation with, interestingly, the people for whom you are trying to design a solution. None of this, let's go off in our back room, like the Wizard of Oz behind a curtain and see what we can come up with. But instead, you co-create. You allow yourself to diverge and converge and kind of come up with a variety of ways to tackle the problem. And you prototype really simply solutions to that problem and test them. It's just a radical idea to test really early. While you've just got this rudimentary prototype, and then observe what the users are doing with it, get feedback from them and refine it and iterate from there. So that just seemed to fit so neatly into instructional design, and it made a lot of sense, particularly the starting with the empathizing and the pulling the user in at the very beginning. But I liked it. Design thinking is a human-centered process as opposed to a business-centered process. And that made sense to me. It seems like learning ought to be a learner-centered process and not a corporate-centered process or organization-centered process. So that's kind of how I got interested in it, because I was frustrated.
Yeah. I mean, there's lots of, I often see in this, in this approach, there are parallels to what we, you know, have always done. And, you know, I'm sure say with Addy, I mean, the empathize and define sections, they have parallels to, or they are a version, I guess, of say analysis, right? One of the things though, that, that often catches me is, I mean, that word empathize, it brings a level of, maybe an emotional connectivity to it, as opposed to analysis, which sounds like it's trying to be something that is objective or scientific or cut and dried or something in a sense. So so that's one of the places where the, you know, there's overlap, I feel, but and there's also though a very much a difference to, you know, that's being brought forward on this. So
there is, and yeah. I have a slide for that one too, Chris.
What a coincidence.
No, you didn't know that.
I didn't know that. So
let's lay it over and say, well, what would it look like if you were doing this for instructional design? And I think that to your point about empathize seems to make people kind of uncomfortable. Like that's a little too soft. I don't know. We're not about that. So I like to think of it as get perspective or gain insight. And that includes getting into the thoughts and feelings of your learner, right? So I think it's the beginning and kind of the end that get really different if you lay over design thinking to this. Because you usually are starting with someone coming to you with a problem. You don't get the chance to just define the problem yourself. So I think that's different. And so then if we think of what we've always done with ADDIE analysis, you're right. It's just that this is different. We try not to just focus on the demographics. What's their educational background? How many years experience? Instead, we're looking at finding the pain points, the motivators, what they're seeing and hearing, what they're saying and doing, what they're thinking and feeling. And I think that's a key difference in terms of the analysis and how we go about it. It's not just documenting the tasks, but what are they thinking about? What are they hearing from other people, et cetera?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when we're given the time to do that kind of work, it's always, it's fun, and it's a real, you know, you've got a good manager or you're at a good company when they really do, you know, kind of value you saying, hey, give me some time to take a look at, you know, how people are doing the work first and do a little bit more analysis right off the bat. If you watch any like documentaries on companies like IDEO design firms and some of the experienced design companies, and or just read some of the blog posts that they write about how they go through that process, that first step there, all of their designers have to really practice at clearing their head of all preconceived notions of what they're about to walk into, and they just document everything, even the silliest little elements of what they see the people doing. They try to just capture it for what it is, not what they think it is, and they try not to go into solution space too fast and all of that. And I think that's hard for people in general, right? Even for us, we like to go right to the one thing. Oh, this will be e-learning, or oh, this will be fun as a virtual reality thing, or this will be, you know, we like get excited about the tools we use. I think it's just human nature.
I think it is, but I think we tend to ignore, and I say this all the time, that learning is a journey. It's not an event. And so when you treat it as an event, you get really caught up in building the event.
Yeah.
And kind of thinking about the content that you want to stick in it instead of the experience that people need to have. And what's going to motivate them to want to even engage in the experience, notice the need to learn, commit to the learning. What are they going to do after they go to your event? How are you going to get them to reflect on it or repeat and practice? All that kind of stuff gets ignored. There's a great story, TED Talk, by a guy named Doug Dietz, who works for GE Healthcare. And I got a picture for that, too. So I'm going to show you this. So Doug designs MRI machines. And I don't know if you guys ever had an MRI.
Yes, I have. Okay.
Well, we're of a certain age, so we probably have.
Sooner or later.
I'm claustrophobic. I don't know about you guys. Are you claustrophobic? Either one of you? Anybody out there listening?
I thought I was, but when I got into it, it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. I can be in certain situations, but I was okay in that for some reason.
You are okay. I had to meditate my way through. I've had to have several of them. I had the Peyton Manning surgery a few years back. And so there were a lot of MRIs before that was done. And that thing being right in front of my face, and it's really loud, and you're told you can't move, which immediately makes you want to move. Yeah. Everything starts to itch as soon as they tell you don't move for the next 45 minutes. But imagine if you were three and you had to do this. Doug happened to be at a children's hospital, and he was admiring his beautiful new machine that had just been installed, and he's talking with the tech. And she says, you're going to need to step out. I've got a patient coming through in, and they're going to need to get an MRI. So he steps out into the hallway, and he sees a little girl about this little gal's age and size, and she's walking between her mom and her dad, and she is crying. And they get closer and closer, and he's just standing there outside the door, and he can hear dad. Dad bends down and he says, now you remember, we talked about this. You've got to be really brave. Doug is mortified. He actually started crying himself. He had no idea that people would react to this machine this way, that there'd be such fear or terror in it. And it made him really rethink it, because he was seeing it through the eyes of this little girl and her mom and dad. And the reality is, as I learned in this TED Talk, 80% of juvenile patients have to be sedated to get an MRI because they're so scared. So this is what's cool. And it really resonated with me. I'm going to show you this other picture. He brought a bunch of people in here to redesign the experience of getting an MRI. So the machine didn't change. So if you think about any process that you have in an organization, processes may not change. What's the experience of going through that process and how you encounter it? And he came up with this, and I thought this was amazing.
Yeah.
They took sedation rates down from 80% to less than 1% where they used these kinds of things. There's a bunch of these. You guys can Google it and go out there and you'll see they've come up with all sorts of motifs. And he said one of the highlights was when he got to hear a little kid say, can I do that again? After he finished the MRI, because they made a whole story out of it. You know, and this one, I think you're going camping and you're on a camp out and you're obviously with looks like Tigger sitting there, or Tony the Tiger, something like that, doing a sing along, et cetera. But they made it really cool. So I think that's a great way to think about how do we do our learning experiences like that? How do we make those be something that resonates with people, that addresses their fears, their anxieties, or flat out dislike of what they're going to go through, and turn it into something magical for them.
Mm-hmm. Just going to back up, because there's been a couple of really neat comments. I just want to, Kim W. is saying, I work for the ad firm that created the slogan Got Milk. This is exactly how they came up with it. So that's
cool.
That's pretty cool, eh?
Yeah.
No kidding. And there's also been some questions. Helena kicked this off about what about creating a journey map as part of the process also?
I think that's one of the most powerful parts of it. So as you think about, people always say, so what exactly are you taking from this? And there's some tools that I think we can use and pull into our instructional design process. The first is an empathy map. Before you even get to a journey map, to understand what is it that people are thinking and feeling about what you're asking them to do, what are they hearing around them? But a journey map is really useful as well. And the first time I ever did a journey map, I was sitting in a design meeting and we were struggling to understand, it was for a product launch. And not going to reveal any of the specifics about it, but the questions were being asked, well, they're trying to include all this technical content about the product, all of its features. And it's like, gosh, that's a whole lot of information. Exactly what does a sales call look like? when a rep is going to be positioning this product. And so the people are sitting in the room, well, I don't know. I've never been on a sales call. It's like, that would be kind of important. But it turned out that one gentleman says, well, I have. He goes, I used to be a sales rep, and here's how it went. And so he started outlining the journey of positioning a product with someone and how they would go about doing it. And it was like the Red Seas parted for the rest of the people in the room, which happened to be all the marketers or the technical people who felt like it was so important to tell all the technical details of the product. And when this individual started explaining the flow of the sales call and what usually happened and where this kind of stuff would even come up in the conversation and what stuff would never come up in the conversation, it ended up completely changing the learning experience that we designed. And I've never forgotten that moment of people sitting there looking in the room like, well, I don't know. And since then, I've done a lot of work in pharma, and those poor sales reps, getting access to a physician at all is really hard. But when they do, sometimes they only have 30 seconds, and you will see people doing 2-day launch meetings with 100 slide decks to communicate everything about a product that's not going to align at all with the journey that someone's going to take in trying to effectively position that product.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Pardon me. Helen is also asking in the questions, how do you create user personas when you're developing for external clients?
So I think I'd need a little bit more context, because we actually will pull together a group of folk in a virtual room or a live room, and we'll kind of just ask them those questions. You can Google again. I've got a picture of a simple empathy map in here. I can show an example.
Sure.
So yeah,
people were wondering if you had any resources for that.
Yeah. Well, these ones are easy. And I can also include, obviously, I'd love to pitch the book here, because a lot of these things are in the book. But you can Google empathy maps and personas and find gobs of them on the internet. But I'll show you, we use this really simple framework. And then I'm going to show you for a sales rep how that ends up panning out, because I think it's really helpful to see it in context. So here, the question we asked reps was, what is it like when you go after a launch meeting and now you're supposed to sell this thing that you heard about in a launch meeting? So that was the context that we gave them. So you give them a context and a prompt, and then you say, so what are you thinking about? And the stuff in the orange boxes is the stuff that we cued in on and said, that's important. We need to pull that forward. So how am I going to fit this message into my call time? Number one thing that they're thinking about. Then they're seeing or hearing. We include some of that stuff. What are you hearing from the healthcare providers? What are you hearing from your colleagues? What are you feeling? I feel overwhelmed. When I was in the actual workshop stuff, I thought I understood everything that was being said and explained, but now here I am back in my work world, and now I'm feeling really overwhelmed and like I don't understand. And so then what do they do? And this, you guys, is really key. If you look at this, what we heard is, I avoid selling it. I have a really big portfolio of other things I can sell that I'm successful at selling. I don't feel confident here, so I kind of avoid selling it, which is the exact opposite, obviously, of what the business consultant needs them to do. But you can look at their motivators. They're motivated by hitting their sales goals. So, well, if I want to hit my sales goals, I'm going to do what I can successfully hit them with. But at the same time, I also care and am motivated by helping patients. So you've got something to work with here. And then the pain or challenge is the time it takes to really get comfortable selling it. So now we have a lot of clues that can help us think about what kind of experience do we want to design. And this is a really simple template. Anybody can use it. So you've got that empathy map, and then you just convert it into these statements. And You can do this live with just post-its, or you can do it virtually, either with a PowerPoint slide where you're just typing in as your folks talk, or with a mural board or mural or whatever. And then that gets converted to the question about a persona into a profile. So we'll take the outputs of the empathy map and we'll stick them into a persona that is representative. And that's what we always explain to clients. This isn't a real person. This is a realistic persona that represents the people that we've talked to. And I like to always have a key phrase for my personas. And the key phrase here is, show me how to use this information within a sales call. That's what I most need to know. And then we'll like to talk about their sales call realities, which that's important to me because of that story I told you about being in that room where no one had a clue what the sales call reality was. And then I like to get a little bit of the personal profile, which comes from traditional ADDIE, and understand a day in their life. So what is a work day? If we're going to learn in the flow of work, what is the flow of work for this person? And how are we going to make that work?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have some conversation and question around task analysis and how it relates to this. And I kind of see it as like task analysis is kind of best when you're going after something specific. Like if you've, you know, what are the specific details of, you know, like logging the information you're getting in the conversation into Salesforce or whatever CRM tool you're using, right? There might be a task analysis that's good for identifying that stuff, but this higher level stuff of trying to understand their environment and understand how they're doing their job and what those goals are. And every call is going to be a little bit different, but the tasks that they go through for each call, you know, how you go through those things, those might be some very, you know, discrete tasks, but the bigger picture of how do you do it? And it's different every single time. And so you can't like automate too much of it, right? You have to understand through a story like this.
Yeah. And I think there's a risk when you go straight to task analysis. This is another story from a long time ago. They were having problems in a manufacturing plant with, again, this is pharma related. There's something called aseptic technique where you have to behave in a completely sterile way, ironically very relevant, I guess, with the pandemic, when you're manufacturing certain drugs. They have to be manufactured in a sterile environment, which means that you have to wear certain equipment, you're moving in a certain way, et cetera. And they do this thing called environmental monitoring. And that measures the contaminants in a space. And they use that to kind of make sure that they're staying sterile. Turns out that the way that the process for doing the environmental monitoring in the aseptic environment was created was a group of people sitting in a conference room saying, what are the steps? Nobody had actually gone with an environmental monitor and executed all the steps in the process. And they were having troubles. They were having all these deviations and they couldn't figure out why. And so I said, well, let's just walk through all the steps. You take me through the process and we're going to just do it. And it was comical sitting in there like, oh, well, I do this thing. I guess that's not in there. Or I do this in this sequence and not the other way, that's not in there. So you need that level of task analysis, but you also need to understand the context and the constraints when someone's trying to do it. So I think, Brent, that's what you're getting to, and Chris, there's two kinds of journeys going on. There's the literal task, and then there's almost the meta around how someone does the task.
There was a comment in the chat earlier. I love it when you sit down with the SMEs and they say, here's the documented process, but here's how we actually do it. Someone had commented on that even earlier in our conversation. And that's just ringing so true right now based on that story, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
And there was another question. Jill was asking in the question panel, do you find you in using this process, you become ensnared in process improvement versus creating learning for an established process?
I think it's the MRI. The story is the MRI. Another story. And it's in the book, but it's so I can talk about it. Next Stage produces home hemodialysis equipment. So you can imagine anything that would be more scary than having to do dialysis on yourself, which is what you're teaching people to do with home hemodialysis. It's a difficult process to learn. It takes multiple weeks to learn it. We're not changing that machine, and we're not changing the process by which blood goes in and out of your body and back into that machine. We needed to reimagine the process by which they learned how to do it. So being able to see the process executed in context and talk to the patients who are going through it, literally you'll see patients in like a recliner in their home environment. And there's this big piece of equipment next to them, and there's a blanket, and they've got their arm out. I'm kind of showing here with a, they have to self-cannulate, stick the needle in, then that get the tubing and it goes through it. And they're kind of confined, right? Their arms out, they're doing that. So how likely are they going to be to balance a laptop on their lap and go through modules designed to teach them how to do this or to reinforce what they're doing, or to even look at a binder of material? So we redesigned it so it fits on this, and they can do it with one hand. And that was a big battle to make happen, because there were many inside the organization from the business perspective that wanted it all to be on an iPad. And there's good reasons for that, but understanding, you know, for maximum benefit to the patient, it was hearing the patient's voices in the room saying, I won't use an iPad, but I would use my phone. Mm. And so not changing the process, but it's like the MRI, we got to figure out how do we redesign around it to make the process more accessible and understandable to the patient.
Yeah. Donna threw in a comment in the chat. I've used design thinking for training. We almost always change the process while we're identifying the areas for training. Analysis can reveal a lot of things, can't it?
I think sometimes that's why people don't want to do it. If we don't analyze it and we don't design evaluation metrics, then we don't have to find out whether it was successful or not.
We don't know how bad it is. We did that with software and business process training when I worked at Intel eons ago. We would always be scratching our heads going, why is the process like this? We were just out there watching people do it, and it's it is not. And then we'd go back to the process team and they'd be like, oh, that's great input. I wonder why, you know, why aren't you guys in on all of these meetings at the beginning of the project? And it was like, well, you know, we ask ourselves that question all the time too.
But here's another story as you think about it. We scoped, at the request of a customer, a 12 module curriculum on this new role that was going to be happening, a new system. And we begged, and we got a couple of people who are in that role to be in the meeting. And we started talking about it, and they were like, we would never sit down and go through all these modules. Never. We would want to just be able to look it up in the moment when we need to do a particular process. It changed everything. We ended up coming up with like a Netflix-like interface where you could use a search bar to look for the specific thing you were trying to do. Imagine this, you guys.
Yeah, go for it, right?
Then they could watch the little 2-minute thing that showed them how to do it. I just so mind-blowingly innovative, right? To just think about, maybe they just need to look it up. But yeah.
Well, access has always been my biggest sort of pet peeve in when people come to us for, and ask the training department for training. It was one of the things I learned over the years, was that a lot of times you can solve a lot of perceived training problems by just allowing the right people access to the documentation that already exists in the format, even that it already exists in. Nothing really needs to be done. You just have to take off the lock and key to get into that particular server or that particular you know, area of the intranet, or, you know, or expose one department's files and folders to another department that is actually working, you know, integrated with them. And they have meetings together, but they're not allowed to touch each other's stuff. And so it's locked off and you don't have permissions, and you got to go to IT and go, can I have permission? Well, then, you know, you got to get eight different managers to sign for it. And it's like, if these people just had it, we wouldn't have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on training them on it, because they could just learn from them.
Which kind of goes to getting the, to your point, Brent, about getting the right people in the room to talk about what the problem is that you're trying to solve. And understanding it.
Yeah.
I think that was what was so powerful in that one meeting, by putting the actual user in there, the customer who was asking for all these modules was able to hear from the user's mouth, you know what, I would never use those. And since they were going to spend a lot of money to create those modules, that meant something to them.
Yeah.
Well, what would you use instead? And why would you use it? It's just a very different conversation. It's like we're all telling ourselves a story about what the problem is, in your example, Brent. And I think we do it over and over again. And if you just put all the people in the room and they could each share their story and their perspective, you could get to a truer space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If that's Helen, design thinking, then I'm all for it.
Yeah. Heather's brought up, and Helena, reinforcing a question that Helena had asked, and I think it's very pragmatic. You know, how much time is allocated for, you know, for that empathy stage? Is it much different than what we would normally predict to be taking in say the ADDIE model for analysis there?
No. And I think oftentimes it takes less, because I think there's ways to shortcut it. I'm amazed at what information you can get out of a handful of interviews. So the focus group of 4 to 6 people, or a few interviews, and asking these questions, because you're in some ways you're looking for different information when you dig into the thoughts, the feelings around an experience, or what people are thinking about as they're going to execute something. And then you can also, there's a great book called Google Sprints, which talks about the challenge of trying to do rapid design. It's using a design thinking approach, and you can shortcut it. Common objection we get is the learners don't have time to spend all this time with us designing. Well, that's okay. Bring them in a few key moments in your process. You don't have to have them sit with you for 3 solid days. You can have them come in at key moments and give you feedback and give you perspective. I think it's just a bunch of hooey when people want to use the time as the objection. I think that what they're afraid. They're afraid of something different. They're afraid of looking foolish. They're afraid of getting blowback, and that it's going to be a waste of someone's time. So that's where bringing some success stories can help. I think the MRI, so I've used that MRI story so many times, and the looks on people's faces when you do the reveal, it gets them every time. So yeah. Giving them a common story and ground on which to say, this is why this can matter.
And Kim is asking in the questions as well, is this in any way at cross purposes with competency-based or backward design, where business performance improvement through behavior change is the goal, and where we're often told to start?
Okay, I'm not sure I'm following that question. So is it at counter purposes with behavior-based design? I think it's actually supporting it, because mindset influences behavior. So the experiences we have influence our mindset. Our mindset influences our behavior, and our behavior influences the outputs we get.
Yeah, and even the.
Oh, sorry. What you were saying about just showing that picture, if you can show people something that's even similar, they can make that cognitive leap to what you're trying to apply the same theory on. And sometimes all you have to do is just shake people out of their way that they're stuck in. And a great story like that, it often is enough to do it for them to go, oh, yeah, that's right. We should probably do that.
Yeah. And I think even the story you just told about the pharma sales being unsure about what to do, and therefore not, introducing that into their sales call processes, et cetera, and that so the process of doing this actually reveals that there's a hindrance to achieving the business performance improvement, which is, you know, to increase sales or to promote sales of say a new product. So it certainly seems to, you know, support that actually very effectively.
It does. And it really becomes when you can pull through, you take the empathy map, you pull it through to the persona, and then you pull the persona through to now let's think about what the journey needs to look like. I'll show you one more image here because I think it's kind of helpful in people seeing how this aligns. Maybe. There we go. So you can kind of see where we pulled through the threads up here, the threads from the persona that this rep values hitting sales goals and helping patients. She wants to know how I use it within a sales call. And then she struggles to build confidence. So then we took that through the steps of the learning journey, which we define as noticing a need to learn, committing to learning, doing the actual learn and practice, repeating and elaborating, reflecting and exploring, and finally, you're able to sustain it long term, which goes to that performance-based outcome. So then we put these components together for the journey, launching a campaign beforehand to get them to notice and think, oh, maybe this might be different. In the learn and practice, it very much influences it because, well, how about we start with some demos of what various sales calls might actually look like, so they can see worked examples and then they can practice. And then give them, they already had a video coaching tool they were using, rehearsal. Well, setting that up so they could do some practice scenarios and get feedback on them, and then using their drive time so they could listen to some podcasts, and then also getting them to share success stories, which most people love to do, by the way. Learners like to talk about their successes, and then the rest of us get the benefit of learning from them. And then giving a coaching guide to the sales managers to use for the ride-alongs. So these aren't like rocket science-y solutions, but they are oriented toward what we heard from the reps themselves, and the reps get to become part of that design for, well, what would help you feel supported and become successful here?
Very cool.
Yeah, I think it's really helpful to see a concrete example of how this all translates, because then you can start to see, oh, yeah, this does link to trying to get them to a place of performing.
Which is why everybody should go out and buy your book.
Yes, please do.
And with the book info for anybody who's joined us late, was posted earlier. Book comes out on June 9th, I think we were saying. Earlier. And Sharon, maybe take a second and toss your contact info, et cetera, where people can find you, because we're reaching that point in time where today's journey map is going to come to a close. See what I did there? anyway, we're so clever in this place, aren't we? But this has been an amazing conversation, and lots of comments from folks about how much they've appreciated the stories / examples that you've given. People here today. That makes such a big difference, moving us from, well, gosh, from the objective information that we might sometimes get in analysis towards something that's maybe more focused in empathy and understanding. So,
for sure.
Well, it's fun to be here. Thanks for having me.
Oh, our pleasure.
We'll have you back for sure.
Yeah, very much so. Brent, let's roll out the music, I guess. It's time to dance
here a little bit. Yeah, thanks everybody for hanging out with us. Hey, next week we're going to be talking corporate podcasting with somebody that's been doing it for a very long time. His name's Evo Terra. So join us very next cool. Wednesday. The event's not up yet, but it will be shortly.
Very cool. I'm going to be embarrassed at how much we're doing wrong when we discover that from that conversation next week, Brent, but oh well.
Yeah. He's going to tell us all the things that we do wrong, but it's going to be That's great right. anyway. Again, it was awesome.
Awesome. Bye. Thanks, everybody. See everybody next week.
Come on, everybody now.